AJ Brady.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for coming to the March 2nd Muscatine City Council meeting. Yes, please.
Councilmembers Raywald.
Present.
Fitzgerald.
Present.
Natfig.
Present.
Buffeto.
Present.
Bynum.
Present.
Harvey.
Present.
Spread.
Present.
All present, Your Honor.
Thank you, Fran. Will you please join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It is so nice to see everyone here tonight, and it is my incredible honor to get to swear in three firefighters tonight. Will firefighters Ben Quick, Mike Lintz, and Craig Schilf join me at the podium, please? Just want to scoot down here a little bit. We'll do you all together. Congratulations. I state your name. Raise your right hand, please. I state your name.
Greg.
I, Greg.
I,
Benjamin Quince.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support.
I will support.
The constitutions of the United States.
The constitutions of the United States.
And the state of Iowa.
And the state of Iowa.
And that I will faithfully and impartially. To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
Discharge all the duties.
Discharge all the duties.
Of firefighter in the city of Muscatine, Iowa.
Of firefighter in the city of Muscatine, Iowa.
As now or hereafter.
As now or hereafter.
Required by law.
Required by law.
Thank you. Congratulations. I want to have you sign
here. Excuse me.
Craig.
Yep.
Right there. And Mike. There you go. Lefty.
Yep.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Please go around front. Congratulations, firefighters. We are lucky to have you, and to all of your families, thank you. You don't have to stay. You can leave and go celebrate.
Just a good view from
CS, hey lady.
The
on the left, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Don't know.
Boy, that thinned the crowd out.
Moving home again. Do, 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 do,
thank you.
Remove his hat.
Thank you, Jerry. We're going to move right along with tonight's agenda. We're still on item number four. We're going to move down to B of that and say, is there anybody here who would like to speak to council about something that's not already on tonight's agenda? Hearing nothing, we're going to move on to the consent agenda. The following items are considered to be routine by the city council and will be enacted by one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a council member so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered in its normal sequence on the agenda. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda, which includes items 6A, items 8A through E, items 12A through C, and tonight's bills totaling $2,431,052.92?
So moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion carries with all ayes. Moving on down to 7. We have 3 public hearings tonight. The first one is a public hearing concerning a proposed ordinance amending Title 10, the zoning ordinance of the city code. Rewriting the zoning ordinance is the most important step in implementing the vision of the new comprehensive plan. The revised zoning ordinance will have sufficient flexibility to be adapted to unique and difficult site conditions to preserve the character of individual neighborhoods and will be more user-friendly. Prior to any formal action by the council, a public hearing is required. Now is the time for the public to comment. Please state your name and address.
Kelsey Brackett, 2817 Mulberry Avenue. Basically, I just had a couple of questions on this that maybe for some clarification and a few comments. As I was reading through the proposal for that, for the changes on there, it looks like the discussion of bees and chickens and other animals of that nature falls under a 2-acre limit. You know, everything, it'd be 2 acres and more. And from what I could find looking through the MAGIC site, it looks like really that's a very limited number of properties in town. And for our neighborhood that recently lost the grocery store in South End, you know, I really had trouble finding any property that would fit the ability to have chickens that was below Hershey, you know, south of Hershey. And just wondered if, you know, maybe the council could take, take a deeper look at that before moving forward, maybe have the zoning commission take a look at it again and see if there's something that they can do where it would be more accessible to the average citizen. You know, I have a fairly sizable property and I can meet the standoff guidelines for those things, but I don't have 2 acres, you know. And looking at that, it looks like it limits it to those individuals that have pretty sizable incomes and doesn't do anything to benefit the larger portion of town that might, you know, want to rely on producing their own eggs and, you know, other things of that nature. So that's my comments on that. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelsey. Andrew, did you have anything to answer him?
I'll just note that the city council did consider a model or draft program for backyard chickens, and council chose not to proceed with that. That was not included in the zoning ordinance. The zoning ordinance is presented as reviewed by the zoning commission and planning and zoning commission and the city council. So city council can certainly choose to consider and review that at some point in the future. If you desire to do so, I certainly wouldn't recommend not proceeding with the zoning ordinance at this point in time. But if council wanted to do a program at some point in the future, the council could certainly choose to do that.
I can see your comments, though, Mr. Brackett, where it could fall under here. Certainly with the language of it being adaptable to certain neighborhoods. Please state your name and address.
Jay Brady, 417 Kindler Avenue. And as city manager indicated, we did come before you in the past to look at a pilot chicken program. That there's still a sizable contingent of the population that is interested in that. And I just wanted to make that known to council and remind them of that, and realize you'll be moving forward with this ordinance, but I think we'll be looking in the future to come up with a program that would be palatable to everybody.
Mr. Brady, can you tell me your familiarity with the chicken project that recently passed in Davenport? Is their project similar to the one that was proposed here?
I have not personally studied it in depth, but my understanding is it is somewhat comparable to what Muscatine was considering.
Thank you. Any other comments?
I'll move to close then.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion carries with all ayes. Moving on to the second public hearing. This public hearing concerns proposed amendment number 1 to the city budget for the fiscal year ending June 30 of 2017. This amendment includes amending both revenues and expenditures to the currently estimated amounts. Amendments also reflect updated capital project construction schedules. Prior to any action by City Council, a public hearing is required. Now is the time for the public to comment.
Move to close public hearing.
I just had a question before we get to that. On the expense is $138,000 for general government. Can we have some examples of what that would include?
General government, and without looking at each individual one, it does include the mayor and council budget, city administrator, finance, HR, legal services, building and grounds, and insurance. And it was a total increase in those areas.
So a combination of all of them?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. Any other comments? Motion to close?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Councilman Raywalt. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion carries with all ayes. Our final public hearing tonight concerns the proposed adoption of the city's budget and certification of taxes for fiscal year 2017-2018. The amounts included in the public hearing notice and budget adoption resolution reflect the budget amounts approved by City Council during their budget review sessions and are in the format required by the state of Iowa. The final budget documents must be filed with the state on or before March 15th of each year. Prior to any formal action by City Council, a public hearing is required. Now is the time for the public to comment.
Move to close.
Your Honor, we do have our presentation for the budget.
Are we going to do one?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Santos told me that we weren't going to do this.
I thought you were going to do it.
I'm going to read it. I'll go quickly.
Oh, okay.
He's going to read it.
That's what I meant.
All right. Yeah. I was led astray.
No, I did promise to go quickly.
So, okay.
Yes. So tonight we just have a short presentation on the overall budget for the 17-18 fiscal year, and I'll just run through this. I'm not going to read through these pages, but we'll glance through and hit the highlights for the 17-18 budget. We have a $62 million operating and capital project expenditures for the next fiscal year, $54,761 in revenues for next year. On top of that, we'll have a transfer in from the transfer of jurisdiction funds, as well as bonding of $3.7 million and $3.1 million. And as noted, we'll be doing just over $3.1 million in GO debt in 2018. The city tax rate remains at $15.67 per $1,000 in valuation. On the next two graphs, you'll have a slide showing, or a graph showing all city revenue sources on the second. And on the second page, a graph of all city expenditures broken down by category and percent, so that you have an idea of where those expenditures and revenues come from. In the back, by the way, We do have a brief definition of revenue, where does the money come from, that if folks are interested in a more, a better explanation of that as well. On the next page, you'll see a breakdown of the city's levy rates by type that makes up the total levy of $15.60 per $1,000 of valuation. On the next page, you'll also find a history of our tax rates in Muscatine for the last 10 years. And, you know, I think it's important to note that since 2010, 2011, the city has not increased its tax rate, and it's maintained at 15.67 for the past six years. So we've got great news. The tax rate remains the same going forward for next fiscal year. And let's see here, on the following page regarding the property tax rate, I would like to note just a couple items, and specifically the 17-18 budget. The property tax levy again reflects not funding 100% of the general fund employee benefits from the employee benefits levy. That amounts to about $230,218 that would be funded from the general fund instead of this levy. That would be about 27 cents per $1,000 evaluation that could be included in the levy rate, but is being taken from the general fund. On the next page, you have the increases and decreases in the various levies that the city currently levies: general fund, transit, tort liability, employee benefits, debt service, and the levy. Totaling $15.67. The emergency levy was eliminated in 2011, 2012, and remains eliminated going forward or into the next fiscal year. For a homeowner of a $100,000 home, that amounts to about a $20 increase. While the levy remains the same, the residential rollback does not, and that is adjusted on an annual basis by state law. So you will see an increase based on the residential rollback, which is out of the city's hands, but the levy rate is remaining the same. There is no change in the commercial and industrial property tax rates. They've gone down the past 2 years from 100% down to 90%, so there is no change in commercial and industrial property tax. Multi-residential properties will be declining over several years. And this next fiscal year, they'll see a $59 decrease over the current year in taxes due. On the following sheet, you'll see a breakdown of the tax rate by percentage. Now, this does not this does show the city's rate remaining the same at 15.57. We have used the last year rates from the school and the county, but it does give you a general idea of the breakdown or the total percentage of how the combined levy is broken out across the county. City being at around 38.5%. General fund budget highlights on the next page. General fund, the budget projects a general fund ending balance as of 2018 of $4,300,000, which is 22.3% of general fund expenditures. This meets our minimum 16.7% required. Just below that, you'll see the ending balances for the last 8 years. We ended this last, we're estimating a revised ending general fund budget for 16-17 at 22.9% over the 19.5% that was budgeted. So an increase, another positive impact on the general fund. The next several pages includes seven significant budget items and assumptions that we included in this year's budget. Run through a few of those. Police and fire pension contributions remain at just over $1.3 million. There's a cost of living increase is included in the budget at 2.9%. Health insurance premiums began in January at an increase of 15% and for next fiscal year as well. We have an increase in full-time positions with the new library. Those are found in the Buildings and Grounds Department. We have a small decrease in the library of 0.14 FTE positions. TIF funds continue to be used for economic development, administrative, legal, and marketing costs. as well as our contribution to the Greater Muscatine Chamber of Commerce and Industry at $38,000. We have additional subsidies noted below. In addition to GMCCI, the Muscatine Humane Society GMCCI receives a subsidy of about $38,000 and $65,000 to the Muscatine Humane Society. The next two items are agreement for services, $25,000 to fund an agreement for services with MCSA remains in the budget, as well as a allocation of 25% of hotel motel tax to fund the CVB. An agreement for services is proposed for staffing of the CVB going forward, and that is actually on tonight's agenda later on in the packet. Again, I think this budget positions the city well to address future economic challenges, maintain existing levels of services to the community, and positions the city well to meet new challenges going forward. Some of those challenges we talked about during the budget process. In the event of significant revenue loss, we do have the utility franchise fee that is available and can be implemented after a 90-day notice period. The budget remains the two police, continues to fund the two additional police officers that were funded as part of the COPS grant, continues to maintain the four new firefighter positions that were added last fiscal year, includes merit increases for full-time employees based upon performance at 3%. The 15-16 and 16-17 budgets include a number of significant building and facility improvements, and those are funded from the 2016 bond issuance, and we are planning to include additional deferred maintenance items in the 2018 bond issuance as well. The budget does account for a 3% increase in sewer and collection and drainage fees per the resolution that was adopted in 2013. The only other fee increase that was included in the budget was a $1 increase per round for regular play and $25 for season passes at the golf course. No other increase in fees are included for the transportation, landfill, refuse, collection, ambulance, transit, parking, and boat harbor at this time. As you all may recall, the landfill fund was eliminated, the deficit was eliminated in 2014-2015, and we have its next cell development can be funded from that fund balance, and we're looking to do that this coming summer and begin construction. Enterprise operating funds have positive fund balance other than the refuse collection fund, and that was a planned deficit with the purchase and acquisition of new refuse trucks, automated collection trucks, and the transfer station deficit shows a positive balance after the adjustment in or reallocation of the fees tipping from fee. What's that?
Tipping fees.
Thank you. Reallocation of tipping fees for that two-year period that the council agreed to. There's a number of capital projects identified on the following page. I won't run through each of those. Mississippi Drive Corridor Project, Quiet Zone, number of deferred maintenance, sidewalk program is continuing, and of course, several other projects as well, including the trail and the water pollution control plant are identified. A couple of items, as typical, we have assumed and that the state will maintain the backfill for commercial and industrial property rollbacks. Police and fire pensions will continue at a significant cost, but at a decreased cost over the next several years through 2037. We have maintained automatic traffic enforcement revenues in this budget at an amount of around $700,000 for 17-18. That $700,000 would be equivalent of 83 cents per $1,000 evaluation. And as noted earlier, we do have the utility franchise fee that could be used in the event that it is necessary. In addition to that, on the following page, you'll note that because of our fund balance and the fund balance policy, we do have the ability to use that for one-time expenditures and extraordinary circumstances should things change during the legislative process. Having a strong fund balance and the fund balance policy in place will allow time for staff and city council to plan for how to address any revenue reductions if they are to occur during the legislative session. And then, as I noted, on the last two pages, we have some definitions. Where does the money come from? Category information that gives you a little better and more in-depth explanation of those revenues. So with that, I'd just like to simply thank city staff, finance department, Fran, and the city council for an excellent budget program. I think everything went very well and smoothly. Appreciate everyone's hard work and another good year.
And this document, as well as the budget, is online already?
The budget's been online through the process. Tonight's presentation and...
Will be online.
It will be on.
Will be online as well.
So if someone wants to review what was said, they can nitpick it.
The next step will be the preparation of the budget message and the budget compilation of the budget document. And each of those, that entire document will be placed on the web as well and available for hard copy for those who would rather have a rather
paper.
Large copy.
Yeah. So.
Does anybody have any questions? Hearing nothing, do I have a motion to close this public hearing?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We're going to move down to 11A on tonight's agenda. We have a first reading of an ordinance amending Title 10, the zoning ordinance, of the city code. Is there a motion to approve the first reading of the ordinance as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, Councilman Spread, how do you vote?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
Bynum?
Aye.
Sacedo?
Aye.
Raywalt?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
And Nattvig?
Aye.
Motion carries with all ayes. 11B, presented for City Council's consideration, is the second reading of an ordinance vacating the city right-of-way, the old Sunmart Alley. Come and Go has acquired the old Sunmart site located at the northeast corner of 4th Street and Cedar Street. Their intent is to relocate their existing store at the northwest corner of 5th and Cedar Streets to this location. Come and Go is requesting the alley running through this block be vacated. Is there a motion to approve the second reading of the ordinance as submitted?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Are we still going to have a third on this one? A third reading on this one, too?
Yeah.
Can we waive that third?
Certainly.
Can we waive the, so we can go right into it?
We could if you want to.
If you so chose.
Want to make a motion to do that.
I'd like to make a motion for that.
I'll second that.
Councilman Raywalt, how do you vote?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
Nattvig?
Aye.
Sacedo?
Aye.
Bynum?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
And Spread?
Aye.
We need to do the original motion. Councilman Sacedo, how do
aye.
You vote? Bynum?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
Spread?
Aye.
Raywalt?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
And Nattvig?
Aye.
Motion carries with all ayes. 11C. We have a resolution approving amendment number 1 to the 2016-2017 city budget. Is there a motion to adopt the resolution as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, Councilman Nattvig, how do you vote?
Aye.
Raywalt?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
Bynum?
Aye.
Sacedo?
Aye.
And Spread?
Aye.
The motion carries with all ayes. 11D, we have a resolution adopting the budget and certification of taxes for fiscal year 2017-2018. Is there a motion to adopt the resolution as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
Any discussion?
Just a comment thanking Nancy and her staff for getting the budget into the form that the state will accept.
Yes. And Nancy, I know that there was a lot of questions that I did. The little houses that show kind of where the money goes. I know that those were things that helped me tremendously to be able to see that. And I think it'll help the public as well to be able to understand that. And so I know, Greg, you did a tremendous amount as well, too. And so I know the other department leads did as well. And just wanted to thank them for that. It was a tremendous amount of work that people don't understand how much time it takes over our time to be able to get that to budget and be successful and positive with the numbers that we have and not increase taxes.
Thank you. Councilman Spread, how do you vote?
Aye.
Bynum?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
Sacedo?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
Raywald?
Aye.
And Nattvig?
Aye.
Resolution is adopted with all ayes. 11E. Presented for City Council's consideration is a resolution awarding the contract for the Mississippi Drive Corridor Project. Five bids were received for the project. KE Flatwork submitted a bid that appeared to be lower, but following a review of the bid, it was determined by staff that the bid was irregular and non-responsive. Therefore, staff is requesting that City Council take action to award the bid to Langman Construction in the amount of $8,787,676.34. Is there a motion to adopt the resolution as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
Second. Any discussion?
Yes, who has a copy of the contract? Copy of the contract?
The contract or the bid?
Well, the contract.
The contract would be at the following meeting.
Yeah, okay. Because I want to, you know, Jim, you know.
Yes.
Okay, maybe I can get together with you this week. Thank you.
The contract and bid bond is typically follows after awarding of the bid. So that would be at our meeting on the 16th.
Got it. Thank you.
Welcome.
Mayor.
Yes.
What was the difference in dollar amount from KE Flatwork Work and Langman Construction?
$117,000.
Council, Mayor, he's right. It's a $117,000 difference. And these are representatives from KE Flatwork, and they have some things that they wish to share, and I'm going to let them have the floor.
Thank you, Jim. Please state your names for council.
My name is Calla Parketti. I'm an attorney with Schenthaler, Bartelt, Kaler, and Reichs out of Maquoketa, Iowa.
Lucas Cleaver with KE Flatwork, Inc., the low bidder.
Thank you.
Council members, as I stated, my name is Calla Parketti, and I'm an attorney for the firm Schenthaler, Bartelt, Kaler, and Reichs out of Maquoketa. And I represent Lucas Cleaver here in KE Flatworks. And we are here because of concerns that we have with the bidding process for the Mississippi Drive Corridor project. Specifically, in the motion that you read, you stated that there were some irregularities and with the... Excuse me, let me get the exact language. Irregular and non-responsive in the bid by KE Flatwork, and we are looking for the what exactly made the bid irregular and non-responsive. My understanding is that the main issues were with line 19 and 20 of the bid, and that after the bids were asked to be in, KE Flatwork found that the city wanted to use line 19 and 20 to backfill holes that occurred from digging and removing unforeseen objects. However, nothing in the specs for line 19 or 20 mentioned unforeseeable items in the ground, and we feel if that is the reason that the bid was rejected for being unresponsive, it should have been that should have been included in the specs. We also understand that there were issues that the line 19 and 20 were penny bid, and that that they had issues with that. However, it's our understanding that penny bidding for unsuitable backfill is common in bids. In fact, when the city of Muscatine accepted the bid for the Mulberry Avenue project last May, the contract had a penny bid for the unsuitable backfill, and eventually the Iowa Department of Transportation found that entire bid to be responsive. So this is not uncommon in the recent history of the City of Muscatine's bids. Further, the winning bid, Langman Construction, today also had unbalanced bid items of penny bids in lines 8, 29, and 37, but their bid was deemed responsive, and we were looking for more specific information as to why. finally, Iowa Administrative Code 875-156.2, parenthetical 73A and parenthetical, requires the City of Muscatine to receive statements from each bidder stating the bidder's resident status. KE Flatwork provided the city with such statement, and it is our understanding that KE Flatwork is the only Iowa resident who submitted a bid. The purpose of that administrative code section is to give preference to in-state residents who bid on public works projects to the extent that Iowa residents are given preference in other states as well. So we are asking today for more specificity on why KE Flatwork's bid was deemed irregular and unresponsive.
So did you look at 19 and 20?
I have looked at the
comparison to other contractors that bid it, because the one, the 0.1 penny compared to Langman's, Valley, Miller, or other Valley Flatworks?
I have a copy of the tabulation of bids. I do not have the specific bids from all four.
Okay, it's online. It was online for this meeting today, yes. And just to kind of give you an idea, the one penny for the LA Flatwork, which was total amount, was $188 compared to Langman's for $20 for unit price, was $377,000. So our concern, from my view, is just going to say, well, is that going to be a change order for $377,000?
Well, and
down the road, when we don't identify, because for me, that's going to be something that you're going to say, well, 19 and 20 backfill material, that's, you're going to have backfill.
I understand, and Mr. Cleaver was asked about that, and he stated that he had.
My understanding is that there was an email sent to him, and that he clarified in his email.
And there's a correction. There's two emails. Only one of the emails got to the city attorney.
Okay, and what would those emails say?
Sorry. These are both the emails. After a phone conversation with Mr. Edmund, he told me that the attorney did not give both the emails. So I think,
sorry, okay, sure.
If he gets the chair. So I feel that it's important that both the emails that were turned in to Mr. Edmund were bought out for you guys.
I would also note that line 8, which Langman did do a penny bid as well, their amount is $340, where the engineer's estimate is $136,208. KE Flatwork was $51,078. Valley was $34,052. And Miller was $68,104. The same if you look at line 29, and then also there's a significant difference if you look at line 36, which were also penny bid.
Can I explain our, if you read the addendum number one on what the 19, number item 19 is, it is the backfill of the each pipe, and it's 1 foot wider on each side of the pipe, straight up, and then it flares up at the top.
Mm-hmm.
So that is paid just as you put the pipe in. Me being the contractor, the prime, I had electrical contractor, and I had KMA, the excavation contractor. They all gave me two different prices, and then I had my own price for the removals of sanitary sewer. So there's three different prices for the one bid item. So as a prime contractor, I had to figure out how
I was going to pay each one for three different numbers for the one line item. So our best case was to put it into the pipe that you lay in the ground. So when you put a piece of pipe in and you get 10 feet, they're getting paid for that 10-foot of backfill instead of the cubic yards, which has to be measured by the inspector. And what happens on a big job like this, we're just in Maquoketa and a big job. There's tons of things going on. So this inspector has to go around and measure the depths of the trenches and figure out how many cubic yards of backfill we are using. Well, there's times he might be a mile down, especially on this project, and we're ready to start backfilling. He's got to come up and measure it and do all his calculations to make sure that he does it right. Our reasoning for our bid was for more clarity. We wanted to make sure that we weren't going to be arguing with an engineer or anybody else. And that's what our company is. We didn't want arguments throughout this project. We know a good working relationship with the engineer and the city council, things just go better and you have a really good project.
So my concern is you emailed this on 2/28/17. The deadline was 2/27, correct?
There's two post emails after the bid with questions regarding. Bill Haas gave me a call, and for Jim Edgman, and so there's two emails after the bid, and there's one email before the bid where I wanted more clarity on that specific bid item. And you can see Mr. Edgman's response on two of the three emails.
What we're looking for is clarity on how the city is awarding a contract to a non-resident contractor that did not have the lowest bid when they have similar penny bids in their proposal is a resident who submitted the lowest bid.
You see where my concerns were initially just on the $300,000.
Yes, I do see those concerns.
I mean, obviously, if there's $117,000 difference overall bid, you see it at the end. Obviously, you don't see that. But from a consumer end, we want to give it to the lowest, but we also want to make sure that we don't have, at the end of the project, seven change orders that equivalent to another $1 million-plus dollars because they didn't see it. That's what our biggest concern is.
Yes, and we understand that. But the other penny bids and the other bid also do have a discrepancy between them as well.
Not $377,000.
Well,
I understand.
$135,000 from the average bid. And you're not going to get change. How are you going to get change ordered? And this is the question that they were asking me before or after the bid. Is they're asking me how about these change orders if I will give the item. You can't talk about what we're going to do with change orders until the bid is awarded. And this is what your staff was doing.
But again, when you don't put anything on it at all, that's the only thing that I think I'm thinking about it from the end. If you would have put something on there, then we can say, okay, well, then you accounted for it.
It is a penny. And in that email, I say, we will do everything that is in that for that penny.
After the deadline, though. That's what you put it on on 228, right? Isn't that when you said that?
That's the question. We will, KE Flatwork will fully execute those two bid items per the contract.
So I'm challenged a little bit by Lucas just because we've discussed this already also as well with our attorneys. And we're not obviously in a position to try to make this a big discussion piece. It's just obviously something that we're challenged with personally because of the information was done past the deadline. And I don't know that without getting some clarity from maybe Greg or with Jim.
Well, my first questions were before the bid.
He has an email in there that was sent on February 23rd. That was before the bids were due. And then my understanding is that the rest of the communication occurred after the bids. The questioning about the, is that correct?
The backfill itself.
About the backfills occurred after
Mr.
the bids
Edgman,
were due.
And we can let him talk and give his.
So first of all, let me say that the last thing that I want to do is complicate everybody's life, like this is complicating everybody else's life, because the easy thing to do would be to just award to the low bidder and move on. But our recent history, both with the sewer separation project and with Mulberry, is that bids like that that are unbalanced have come back to haunt us. They asked for clarification, I think, on what I was trying to make notes. The irregularities with the bid items 19 and 20 are not matters of supposition or guess or opinion. When we hit those two and we questioned those two, we did inquire with KE Flatwork about those one penny bids, and they stated that they had thrown, just as they did just a little bit ago, that they had taken those costs and put them into the linear footage of the items that were to be buried. And they did confirm that in writing too. And in essence, that is, there's a phrase for that. There is a term for that, and it's basically called unbalancing your bid. And an unbalanced bid to that extent is not something that I wish to try to administrate or try to work through again. They did reference Mulberry, and I wish to thank them for that, because the one penny per cubic yard bid that did go in that contract did cost the city about another $100,000. I am not drawing a corollary between that and this, not at all. Even though they are both one penny bids, they were done for completely and totally different reasons, and the result that came from that has no bearing on this whatsoever. Just to elucidate that point a little bit more, in those Mulberry plans, there was a mistake in those plans by the consultant in not clarifying the material that was to be used to backfill those. So that is where that came from. But the inquiries that were done with KE Flatwork definitely confirmed that they had unbalanced their bids. And there is a concern there, because this is Old Town. There are unknown things that we're going to find down there that will require to be backfilled, and that's why we wanted a unit price specifically for that. That's how the contract was set up. That was the intent. And certainly,
Lucas
has confirmed, and I believe it says in that email, that anything that is in the direct line of the trench, that they would honor that. But there are unknown things down there that could potentially put us at odds with one another over that unit price. To address the one pennies that are on Langman's contract, you know, we inquired about those too. Now, I mean, our radar is way up on those. And to give an example, to contrast the two, item 19, you know, has a material cost that goes along with it. You have to buy that material. You have to truck that material to the site. You have to install it. You have to put it in the ground. It becomes very obvious at one penny a cubic yard that there's not even close to enough money in there to even purchase the material. So it's not a matter of question. The items that Langman has their one penny bids on are removal of existing smaller diameter storm sewer. When we ask them about that,
it's sanitary sewer.
Yeah. To remove the sewer, they said that they do that with the same equipment at the same time that they are there doing the pavement removal and the removal items, and they don't anticipate that that's an additional cost. They don't see how they separate those two things out. It's certainly not how we would wish for them to bid it, but when asked if they would honor that unit price for any additional work, the response was yes. The initial response from KE Flatwork on the one penny bids
for honoring that price if it was additional work was that they felt that there was a other pay item in the contract that would be more appropriate. So I think that is just about all that I want to say on those subjects. Again, to reiterate, we don't do this lightly. We don't do this capriciously. We don't do this because we think it's a good idea. We do this because we believe in our heart and our soul that this is the right thing to do for the city. You guys have any other questions?
So do you feel if we were to give it to KE Flatwork, I'm sorry, Lucas.
Yes, KE Flatwork.
And they're capable of doing the work?
We checked references like we usually do. We found the references to be good. We and did some other inquiries. The history of the company is on projects that are mostly smaller than this. But I have no reason to doubt their capabilities. This isn't a question about capabilities.
I'm just asking.
Yeah.
I'm just asking. I want to know. And this is the only group from Iowa that actually bid for this?
The comment that they made is something that I am not familiar with. I mean, this was bid the way we have always bid the work. I don't know of any of those classifications or clarifications or anything else
with regards to that. The code that she read, that was 375 something.
Yeah, yes.
You're not aware of that code?
No, I don't believe that the city has ever required submittals to demonstrate that they comply with that or what. Whatever that requires, I'm not conversant in that.
If we were to move to table this for a week, Greg, is that going to be a problem?
No, it would not delay the shouldn't delay the project contract and bid bond could still be received on the 16th. Give staff and city attorney an opportunity to review the material submitted. You've probably
I'd like to do that if that's okay with all the parties. If we could take a week to kind of review this information a little more and make sure that we're making the right choice here and as a group to make sure that we evaluate it a little more.
I'll second the motion. I assume that was a motion.
That's what I asked, yes.
Mr. Cleaver, did you have a final thought? You looked like you had more wanted to say.
The question was, were we the only Iowa bidder? And the answer is yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we're going to vote on Councilman Santos' motion to table this. Councilman Spread, how do you vote?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
Bynum?
Aye.
Saucedo?
Aye.
Nat Vig?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
And Raywald?
Aye.
And to the original motion, we don't have to do it.
Don't have to.
There we go. All right, we're going to move down to 11F. Presented for City Council's consideration is a resolution setting a public hearing for the sale of real property to the HNI Corporation. In February 16, City Council approved the exchange of 1.53 acres of vacated right-of-way, primarily in Block 70 of Original Town, made up of portions of Spring Street, East 4th Street, and Poplar Street, for 1.63 acres of property currently owned by HNI along Mad Creek between 5th and Washington Streets. Due to a drafting error in the resolution approving this exchange, it is necessary to redo the process in order to produce the documents necessary to close this transaction. Prior to any formal action by City Council, a public hearing is necessary. This public hearing will be held on Thursday, March 16th of 2017 at 7 p.m. Is there a motion to adopt the resolution as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second, Your Honor.
Any discussion? Hearing none, Councilman Raywald, how do you vote?
Aye.
Fitzgerald?
Aye.
Nat Vig?
Aye.
Spread?
Aye.
Harvey?
Aye.
Bynum?
Aye.
Saucedo?
Aye.
The resolution is adopted with all ayes. 11G. presented for City Council's consideration is a request to approve a security fence and maintenance agreement between the city and Grain Processing Corporation. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers has requested, as part of their annual inspection, that a maintenance agreement be completed between the city and other entities that own property where the Mississippi River levee has been constructed. The Public Works Department has taken on the responsibility of managing the levee within the city limits to meet all core requirements. This agreement with Grain Processing Corporation will set forth the requirements of each entity with regard to access to the levee and maintenance of the security fencing that GPC has installed on the levee. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
Any discussion?
So just to make this clear, this is just a renewal of an agreement with them, correct?
This is actually the first time we've had a written agreement with them. It's kind of been a handshake. You know, they built the fence. They're supposed to maintain it. This just puts that in writing so everybody knows it.
Formalizes it.
So we're not building the fence?
No, the fence is there.
It's already there. Yep. Good. Okay, good. That's all I wanted to make
clear. Thank you, Brian. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. 11H. Presented for City Council's consideration is a request to purchase a dump box and lift gate for a sewer truck. Three quotes were solicited with two vendors responding. Staff is recommending approval of the low quote from Knapheide Truck Equipment in the amount of $9,641 for replacement of a 10-foot dump box and lift gate for a one-ton dump truck. There is $11,000 already budgeted for this purchase. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. 11I. Presented for City Council's consideration is a request to approve change order number 5 for the Mulberry Avenue Reconstruction Project. Through the Iowa Department of Transportation specifications for this project, the city was required to evaluate the thickness of the newly constructed pavement and to pay a thickness incentive payment to the contractor if the pavement passes the test. Cores were taken at random locations along the street and random offsets from the project center line and were found to meet the thickness incentive requirements. This change order is to pay the contractor $13,441.33 for the thickness incentive. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. 11J. Presented for City Council's consideration is a request to approve the issuance of a purchase order for a fire bunker gear washer. Three quotes were received, with the low quote being from Century Laundry Distributing in the amount of $6,968 for a Dexter 40-pound C-series washer extractor. Staff is requesting City Council authorize the issuance of a purchase order for this equipment. There is $9,000 budgeted for this purchase. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Just for one, for clarification, is this a washing machine?
Yes. Big. But for the bunker gear, the heavy gear that's worn.
Okay.
Is it a replacement?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. 11K. Presented for City Council's consideration is a request to approve settlement agreements for violation of Iowa Code Section 453A.2, selling tobacco to a minor. agreements were received from Come and Go and Nashfish Company doing business as Wholesale Food Outlet Number 312, with civil penalties totaling $1,500 each. Agreements were also received from DGMB Enterprises doing business as Westside Store, Casey's General Stores, Heinz Standard Service, and Avia LLC doing business as Express Mart, with civil penalties totaling $300 each. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
Any discussion?
Your Honor.
Yes.
A representative from the County Attorney's Office, Dan Williamson, is here if there are any questions. So.
Any questions?
Just to clarify, the difference between the first offense and the second offense is $1,200. Is that what I'm reading here?
Good evening. I'm Dan Williamson from the County Attorney's Office. The answer to your question is on a first offense within, I can't remember how many years it is, I think.
2 years.
2 years?
Yeah.
It's just a straight fine to the retailer of $300. On a second offense, the retailer actually gets an option of either paying a $1,500 fine, or they can have their tobacco license suspended for 30 days. As you can imagine, most retailers think that $1,500 is probably the better the better bargain on that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The request is is approved with all ayes. 11L, presented for City Council's consideration tonight is a request to approve an agreement with the Greater Muscatine Chamber of Commerce and Industry for staffing of the Convention and Visitors Bureau. Is there a motion to adopt the request as submitted?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. 11M. Presented for City Council's consideration is a request to approve change order number 3 for the Art Center HVAC replacement and window improvement project. The contractor has presented 13 additional change authorization requests. Of these requests, only 2 have an additional cost of $4,743.70. The remaining change authorization requests are at no cost to the city. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved, Your Honor.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
So are we done with the Art Center? I mean, as far as change orders and work?
Never say never.
I don't know. I mean,
I think we had this discussion at the staff meeting, but.
I would say we're very close. But as Greg said, I wouldn't say never just yet. This should wrap up the majority and hopefully finish the project soon, but we're going to wait until we're finally done before I go out.
Contractor still on site?
Yes.
Okay.
There's a punch list and a couple other items to finish up, yeah.
It talks about the door in there. Is that the main door there that was supposed to be automated but wasn't? I mean, they could remote control it?
Yes, and it will be put back to automated. There was a mix-up with some of the plans and engineering specifications, so it will be put back to automatic. That's one of them in there, yes.
When do you foresee them to be done, Brian?
Soon.
Wow.
Yeah. I'm going to say April 1. How about that?
Wow.
I hope.
It could be May 1, right?
Not when the snow's flying, though, right?
Okay. Oh, no. We'll be done well before then. The last thing that's out there, we had some concrete damage. That'll be part of it, so we'll have to do repairs on that. Whether we settle that out and they pay us cash and we fix it ourselves, or if they fix it, there's a few items left inside of our punch list that need to be done before we officially sign off on it, and then we'll have the warranty period as well. So it should be, the main work should be done, and it should be open to the public. Well, it's open to the public now, but it should be open for everything here, I hope, by the end of this month. But please don't hold me to that.
But I think the lesson learned from Mulberry was don't give you dates.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm good as long as it's this. I mean, I don't think there's rain delays or anything like that on this.
No, we're in the home stretch. It's just a matter of, but the punch list always seems to take the longest anyway, so.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. 11N, presented for City Council's consideration is a request to approve the asbestos abatement for Beach Lumber. Proposals were solicited from four firms with only two responding. Staff is recommending the proposal from Advance Environmental in the amount of $5,200 to be approved. Funds for this work are budgeted for in the Mississippi Drive Corridor Project. Is there a motion to approve the request as submitted?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
I was not paying attention.
It was Santos and Tom. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The request is approved with all ayes. Moving down to number 14 on tonight's agenda, communication from council. Councilman Saucedo, do you have anything to share?
No, I don't, Your Honor.
Councilman Raywalt?
No, thank you, not tonight, Your Honor.
Councilman Spread?
Nothing this evening, Your Honor.
Councilman Natbig?
Nothing, Your Honor, thank you.
Councilman Harvey?
Nothing tonight, Your Honor.
Councilman Bynum?
Nothing tonight, Your Honor.
Bill?
Nothing at this time, Your Honor.
Councilman Fitzgerald? Staff?
Nothing tonight, Your Honor.
I just had a couple of quick things. Tonight was a really nice evening to do a ribbon cutting for the new culinary program that we're doing with MCC at the old old Button Factory restaurant. Very nice addition. Also, DeBeats restaurant recently had a ribbon cutting as well as the Coffee Belt. So if you haven't had the opportunity to go to any of these establishments, please do so. They're very nice additions to our community. I'd like to give a big thank you to Jefferson School for their Read Across America event today. I had a great time reading Dr. Seuss's Butter Battle book to a whole bunch of first graders, and it was a great time. Lastly, I would just like to say United Way is very close to reaching their goal for their campaign. They're inches away. If we can help put them over that $1 million level, it'll be a win for our entire community. Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
We are adjourned.
Hey, I may be quick.